Now it's about your own experiences with dissociation. This may also be of interest to some. For example, how the process can take place in detail, and what we have just achieved with the dissociation, or how we then use the energy, the stored energy, to reach other states of consciousness. Exactly. Yes, Shiva. Tell me, what kind of symptoms do you have? I'll tell you now, when you start dissociating, or how do you go about it? First I sit down, quite clearly, eyes open, and first look around. Yes, relax your mind very slightly, so to speak, but don't put any pressure on it. It's all compulsion now, because when you do it under compulsion, new thoughts come automatically, that's for sure. And yes, they're gone after a little while anyway, and then you can tell, I'm trying to focus on my midbrain, so to speak, so that the point of consciousness is right in the middle of my head. Where exactly? Really in the middle of the head, so inside, not on top, but inside, in the brain. I'm asking because of the viewers. Yes, yes, exactly. And then you get into a clear trance. So it's not really a trance, but it's not hyperactive either. I don't know how best to say it. And I'm still trying to stay up in the middle head. And then everything starts to tingle, as if the neurons or the synapses were catching a bit on fire. That's how you can describe it. It starts to sizzle everywhere, tingling in the head, and yes. Then yes. Yes, it's difficult to describe, actually. Then I try to make such a switch. It feels like the right half is switching to the left and vice versa. Like it's some sort of sync or something. And then you're totally, totally in, a little bit like that. Yes, it's so hard to describe if you haven't experienced. Exactly, and in this state, in which I am then, in a very clear trance, so you really get very clear in your head, it also expands, it gets wider and wider, that's where I linger, and the more I'm there, stay inside, the more I notice how the energy rises up to the pineal gland. And at some point you realize you've come to a point where you could switch to the right dissociation. You stand there in front of a switch, so to speak, and when you press the button, you're in, you're in. And yes, this switch happens when the energy arrives, I believe, in the pineal gland, probably the I have no idea, I don't know exactly. Yes, and then you are in front of the switch, and then it does switch, and then, yes, then it really starts. I used to notice that the deeper I got into disso, the more tense I became, which means you tensed your fists. Yes, because then the ego or the mind comes into play and says, oh God, oh God, oh God. Or it came paranoia or fears. In the meantime, I think to myself, yes, great, scared, awesome. Because then I know I'm getting very close to the point that is important. Well, that would be the start. The start, yes. How about you? Yes, for me it's like that. I sit down somewhere in the cafe or in an armchair or somewhere else and then start dissociating. For example, by blinking away incoming thoughts. So every time a thought comes in, I blink once and then imagine that the thought will then go away. And over time you can condition yourself to the fact that sometimes you can even blink preventively. If you notice, a thought arrives, and before it can even arrive, I blink it away. Over time you can play with it a bit, and I think it's one of the best techniques for me personally that my thoughts can no longer get in. Or if a thought manages to come in and you think of the first or second part of the sentence, then I blink them away too. In any case, always with the aim that a thought is not thought through to the end. If you now assume that the thoughts come in sentences, then these sentences must not be complete. And so, over time, you get the hang of it in such a way that you can stop thinking after just one word. And then at some point nobody will come in anymore. And the next effect that then occurs with me is that my focus also widens a bit after a while. So I call it a panoramic view, because if you look at a tree, for example, you can only ever see part of the tree, for example, the trunk or the roots or individual branches or individual foliage. But in this panoramic view, in the state of the panoramic view, I can see the whole tree. So I think that's a very interesting phenomenon. So the focus continues. Also, the energy somehow suddenly expands. You have the feeling that your head is getting bigger. Yes, the head is somehow getting bigger, and that way, you have more peripherals somehow. Yes, exactly. So you also notice the difference to the normal everyday situation. It's always a bit blinkered. The focus is always a bit narrower. And in that case, the focus then opens or closes. Widens, and then I already know. Then I have already reached the first step. So at least you've taken the first step. And then somehow I notice that energy is collecting in the solar plexus area. And that energy then also expands and, as you say, often pulls up to the pineal gland or the midbrain. And yes, at some point, when I make progress, a feeling of threat arises. So I notice that my ego reacts at the moment that somehow feels a bit threatened. But that's only the case because in dissociation you can somehow get into a state in which reality suddenly becomes unpredictable because you don't use your mind. You have to use your intellect to be able to calculate reality and your environment. It goes this way, it could go this way, or it does this now and it does this. All of this can be calculated. But of course, if you don't let any more thoughts in and the mind has no more work to do, it can't do any of that anymore. And then, of course, he starts to feel uncomfortable because reality is becoming more unpredictable at that moment. And that creates this feeling of threat. Because then anything can happen, because you no longer check your surroundings. And somehow so comfortable with the life preservation instinct. Everyone does it in such a way that they somehow have to calculate everything in order to be able to feel safe. And then, of course, there is a feeling of insecurity and threat. Like, yeah, now we can't even tell what's going to happen next. We can't either, because the head is off. Yes, yes, exactly. And that's always the next step for me, which is important. And this feeling of threat is then also adjusted in such a way, let me say, that the mind naturally wants you to stop dissociating because it says, I can't do my job if you don't use me. So now think here again, so that we can continue to calculate here. The mind always wants to calculate everything. Yeah, and if you keep going, it's worth it. Then more shows up. Then you realize that a kind of bell is coming around me. I then feel like I'm under a bell, under a big one. And at that moment I'm actually one step further, because then you shield yourself a bit from the outside world and can then concentrate much more on yourself, on your feelings or moods and on what comes in spontaneously. because that also opens up the spontaneity. And the spontaneity also allows for sudden inspirations that then come in from sources that you don't normally use. You often have a few voices in your head, usually when you're on the go with your mind like everyone else is. And when you're suddenly faced with a decision, doesn't have to be a big decision, but a small one. Do I go left or right now, or do I go this way or this way? Then it is often the case that the loudest voice often wins. Right, right, right is very important, and then you go to the right. But at that moment you no longer have these voices in your head that keep saying that, but then you suddenly decide spontaneously what you do, what you do. Other people, whom I then look at, also change. I then had the feeling that everything around me was like a stage, staged, as if everyone was acting staged. And then I know that I have now entered dissociation. And then of course it's important for me to maintain this state. Yes, that was the beginning, I would say, from the disso. And yes, do we want to tell you what are the stumbling blocks that can occur in order to get into the state of disso? Yes, what are your stumbling blocks? So first of all, it has to be mentioned that meditation is not the same as dissociation, because in dissociation you suddenly change focus. In the meditation, even if it's a silent meditation, you still stay there. You know what I mean? The world around you is still the world around you, but when you're in dissociation, eventually there's a switch. It's like a focus shift. Let's probably talk about that too, exactly. Yes, stumbling blocks. First and foremost, of course, thoughts. You blink them away. I always use the stopping technique in the beginning. Whenever a thought came in, stop. At some point I also decided not to think the thought through to the end, but to say, stop. It just doesn't happen that way anymore. When a thought comes in, I don't think it through to the end, but it's also been pretty quiet now. So it doesn't come that often anymore. You have long periods of silence, but when it comes back, I don't think it through to the end. The first word and then it's over. But I keep that relaxed. I don't put any pressure on myself, and that's why it's a bit of a flow. Yes, another stumbling block. The matrix. Suddenly, when you sit down to dissociate, have the intention and want to start, the most unbelievable things happen. And then either your cat comes, a dog, some child suddenly screams, buckets fall over. The waiter comes in the cafe who hasn't come for hours. Or the phone suddenly rings, which hasn't rung for hours. So the matrix, or rather our mind, comes up with some ideas so that you just sabotage yourself and then somehow don't dissociate. You have to know that. Or you get tired. At first I always got tired, much earlier. That doesn't happen anymore either. The mind has already arranged itself with it. Yes. Yes, something else just occurred to me, but I'm sure you remembered that, the stumbling block. Well, I always find it amazing that some force within us that we are not so aware of suddenly somehow influences the environment. Yes, sabotage. Influenced in a way that it kind of sabotages us, right, trying to get into the dissociative state. Exactly. As you said, the phone can ring, the waiter keeps coming or things like that. So that's what I've observed over and over again. The matrix comes up with ideas. Because the matrix's job is to entertain you. Yes, of course. That's their job. And in that sense, the matrix always has to come up with something to keep us entertained in this reality. And then when we start to dissociate, I sometimes have the feeling that the matrix doesn't really know how to deal with it. She thinks, oh, Now I have to animate her on. Yes. He no longer responds to my entertainment suggestions. You don't do that at the moment. Yes. The waiter might stumble, but you don't care. Or the phone rings and you don't answer it at all. Yes. So you notice that at that moment you are also ignoring the matrix somewhere. And I have a feeling the matrix doesn't like it if you ignore it. No, then it really comes down to it. But at some point you actually pass the point where the matrix leaves you alone because it has accepted that you are not going into the attempts at seduction. Yes, exactly. Yes, what other stumbling blocks are there? Yes, another stumbling block is of course the imagination. If you stop thinking, then it's possible that you suddenly have some images in your head about how you see yourself reaching for a coffee cup, or see yourself checking your cell phone to see who wrote. Stuff like that. That such enticing or seductive little pictures come up that make you wonder whether you shouldn't go into them. And of course the matrix can also come up with a few ideas. I now simply call it the matrix because of our environmental reality, which we perceive in this way, and what phenomena can arise there. Anyway, it's amazing to watch. I can think of one more. Suddenly the mind comes around the corner with very exciting ideas. Yes, with great insights where you think, I've been waiting for this my whole life. I have to think about that now. No, not quite so serious now, but in the right direction, great ideas. Sometimes you're in conflict. It's really exciting. Do I want to think about it now? No, I want to keep dissociating. You have to say in your mind. Okay, we still have time to think about this in 10 minutes. But yes, this has happened more than once. Yeah, right. You suddenly become more creative. Yes, the thoughts become more creative, because the thoughts that you think every day are often the same, it has to be said. Many thoughts are routine thoughts that come in and then follow. And if you then dissociate, it's like that then suddenly thoughts come up that you don't know. What creative ideas I already had during the dissociation. Or philosophical thought. Or nerd questions. Very different. What can come in there? And I was able to do that better for myself by asking myself in a quiet minute. Really asking myself. What is really crucially important to think about? Which thoughts are really so important that you have to react to them immediately? Exactly. Dot B. Whether they have any sense at all to think about them? Yes. When I think about it now that all politicians are stupid. Which of course is, but yes. Then, but it has no immediate effect on my current, present reality. To give just one example. Or that you have to wash the car or clean up. Yes, these are all thoughts that have no importance at all in and of themselves. And this consideration, when I thought about which thoughts are really crucial and important to think about, everyone can think about how much is left at the end of the day. Exactly. And that's really just a handful or something. Yes. At some point I came to the conclusion that nothing is so important at this moment that it can still be thought of in 10 minutes. Yes. Even. So you can also train your mind to postpone it. To think your important thoughts later. And then he'll definitely come around the corner again. No question. But it works. Yes. And that is of course the point at which you can then realize that most of what you think about every day is actually thought garbage. Just as it is claimed with junk DNA that it is just rubbish, it will probably not be much different with the thoughts either. Because all the stuff that you think together every day, and you're talking about 60,000 thoughts, as we explained at the beginning, then you can imagine how much of that thought is unnecessary. You don't even have to think about it. There is no law that would say, you have to pay these 60,000 think thoughts every day. Do you get full? Your bar is at 100%. Today you only have 59,000 thought. There must still be 1,000. There is no law or court that could judge that in any way. It's in everyone's own interest or everyone's own choice of how much to think a day, whether to think at all. Is thinking great worth it? Or should one practice thinking less often? In any case, thinking is badly overrated in our society, I have to say that. And when you follow discussions on the internet in such a way that someone says, don't you have a mind? Or, think about it more. Or, yes, if you don't think, you're stupid. Or, people who are not smart are also those who think little. So all such beliefs and opinions are also behind it. But that's completely misleading, because I've never thought as clearly as I do in dissociation, contradictory as that sounds, because when I'm in dissociation, I have a really clear head. Exactly, and that's the difference with meditation. It's just not like that, because you're very much in a trance. And in the dissociation, one is very, very calm inside and still very clear. So we should always point out the difference, because many of our viewers ask, what is the difference? Can't I just meditate? No, the dissociation should be used quite normally in everyday life with all the activities that you do every day. Even washing dishes can dissociate. When watching TV, yes. Driving a car is a bit risky. Also made many times, but I've already done it a few times because it makes sense due to the monotonous work. But then you are no longer so attentive in the car, i.e. on the road. Therefore, it is not advisable. Still stumbling blocks. That one suddenly forgets that one dissociates. Oh yeah, good that you thought of that. This has often happened in the past. An exciting thought was enough. Or maybe just a banal thought was enough. You were so distracted and at some point you forgot that you wanted to dissociate or had just dissociated. And at some point, I just did something other than thinking about such nonsense. Exactly. Yeah, right. Then you forget. Really, you forget that you just dissociated. That you just practiced dissociating. Then you think about it and at some point you think, crap, I let myself be fooled again. Exactly. Been distracted again. Yes, and another stumbling block is of course, getting tired. We also like to sabotage ourselves with this so that we suddenly think, oh, let's do that later, I'm so tired right now. But you're actually not really tired. So there are also states where you are really tired. But actually it's just a trick of the mind in the moment so you don't dissociate. Anyone who has sleep problems will also be able to solve them with dissociation. Yes, exactly. This is true. If you lie down on the couch or on the bed and look a bit at the ceiling or out the window and dissociate at the same time, then it may well be that the camouflage starts to get tired, so that you don't continue. Of course, you also have to get a grip on the tiredness. Because tiredness makes you very sluggish and then you don't feel like continuing to train. Exactly. Yes. Well, during the afternoon nap I always try to dissociate. That means I always dissociate when I take a nap and then I also notice that I'm getting tired. But since the goal of the afternoon nap and dissociation is different anyway, I always have very clear images, hypnagogic states and things like that. you actually want a lucid dream or something. And that's when I notice that it's easier to suddenly get tired. But it's also a matter of training, then always pulling yourself out and waking up. So that works too. Once you've trained it, it works quite well and you can go back into this disso state again and again. Yes, Jonathan, now we've discussed the stumbling blocks, I would say. Let's talk about the everyday benefits of practicing dissociation over and over again. What advantages have you experienced through dissociation? Yes, I have found that I have definitely become calmer inside and more balanced, more harmonious. Because I always work a lot with energies during the dissociation or that it clears itself to some extent. Anyway, you also feel somehow cleansed. And over time, the thoughts in your head become fewer and fewer anyway, the more often you dissociate. At some point you no longer have the need to necessarily want to think. It's easier to simply stay relaxed in your head, without having to or wanting to think something all the time. Well, I think out of my 60,000 maybe 50,000 No, well, it has already been reduced. There are many, many phases, long phases where you simply don't have to think about anything and it's very pleasant when you're not constantly thinking about the train station. So you are much calmer, physically and mentally. Yes, I can also confirm that it makes you calmer, more balanced and you don't take reality as seriously as you might have done in the past. As I said, many who practice dissociation say yes, life takes care of itself, as we said before. And this is how you can imagine it. Somehow you realize that somehow everything is already settled in our life and many things happen all by themselves. You get more into the flow that life just happens. Also the constant fight for survival, in which many people are involved. Where can I get food? Where can I get warmth? Where can I get shelter, a roof over my head and the like? And in dissociation, all of this is no longer considered so seriously. You then take that with you into everyday life. Even. You don't look at it so seriously anymore and somehow you also realize that a lot itself regulates itself. And you just have to think about it. When was the last time someone starved to death in Germany, Austria, or Switzerland? Well, in Western civilization, almost nobody starves to death. It's not like you read the newspaper all the time, someone is starving again today. Don't read at all. So that means that everyone seems to have enough to eat. That may not be the case in other countries or continents, but I just want to say that everything somehow often resolves itself. But what I noticed with many people and with me at the beginning too, that despite everything being secured, you actually always work in survival mode. And I think that's what you wanted to address as well. Yes, and this fight for survival, that just takes a back seat. In dissociation, the then fades into the background. And you don't take a lot of the things that happen around you that seriously anymore. And you no longer identify as strongly with your role in your personal environment. You kind of take a step back. And all these things somehow, you somehow have the inner feeling or the inner certainty that everything will take care of itself. And I would say that it has something to do with the energy that you collect through dissociation or saves. So you can either collect energy in dissociation to use it immediately, or you don't use it immediately, but at a later point in time. For example, I've noticed time and again that when I dissociate, I somehow always have very clear dreams at night, or lucid dreams, or out-of-body experiences that then arise all by themselves, even on nights when you're tired and just thinks, off to bed, I just want to crash, I'm so broken. And then you go to bed and stuff, and then it's off, yes, and didn't do anything for it, didn't meditate, nothing at all. And that is also such an interesting phenomenon that I have noticed again and again in myself and in many other people who work with dissociation, that they then said, you, since I have been dissociating or learning dissociation, since then I have been meditating less at night. But it happens more than it did when I used to meditate. So you can already see that dissociation has a much greater power and energy than any meditation techniques. Yes, well, I notice as a further advantage when I dissociate that my energies flow more and more within me. Well, I can feel my chakras quite well, how they rotate and pulsate, and you didn't see them. And I also feel the blockages, etc. And I notice that the more often I dissociate, the more of it automatically just dissolves. That may be because you don't think, and that the energy then has time and the leisure to flow, and because you also save energy, the pure energy that comes in as a result, the blockages can also be dissolved and the whole energy flow can function better. That would now be my layman's explanation. Yes, exactly. So the energy system gets a little bit more energized and in harmony. That's my impression. Correct. In my case, I have also observed that many of the energies that are available to us on a daily basis are divided into some things or some situations or some areas. Somehow you always wage a multi-front war every day. With the boss, one or the other may always have to assert himself a little somewhere, fight a bit with his colleagues or at university or in the family or with the children or just with regard to the bank account or something. There are so many things that keep people busy, and so they wage a multi-front war with their energy. Energy has to be put in there. Energy has to go in. Energy has to go in. And during the dissociation, I was able to notice again and again that these energies are withdrawn without the situation having changed much. And because the energy was able to withdraw, the energy was also able to gather, and so I was also able to gather myself. I assume that the situations then somehow automatically resolved themselves when they were problematic. By pulling out the energy, right? Yes, that's right, because you usually only feed the negative side of the whole thing with the energy. Most of the that you worry about it, or that you're scared, or that you feel like you're screwing it up, and things like that. And by pulling out the energy, a lot of things take care of themselves. Pulling out, that sounds a bit like you're actively doing it, but I assume it's an automatic process that happens when you dissociate. Right, that's an automatic process that happens there. You don't have to put in a lot of effort or anything. That just happens, doesn't it? Yes. And then all the energy is drawn out of all these wars on the front, and somehow a lot of things resolve with pleasure. You then think the next day or the day later, you think, it's funny that I was worried, but somehow it all sorted itself out now. Of course, these are also advantages that you notice in the initial phase. We've already talked a bit about the spiritual advantage, but we'll definitely get to that in the course of the video. These are advantages in everyday life. Exactly, as you said, the situations then dissolve, and on the contrary, the negative situations not only dissolve, you also have the feeling that the universe is suddenly a bit kind and sends you extra good situations. This is of course now presented in a very esoteric way, but that's roughly how it happens. Those are advantages too. As we said before, life comes more into the flow, into the flux. You automatically attract because you no longer put energy into negative situations, because your head also becomes calmer overall. You also attract what you really want at some point. You also get to enjoy life more, come into being more like that. Exactly. Yes, you just imagine a dispute between two people, a heated discussion. If either of them were to dissociate at that moment and drain the energy from the argument, what happens then? The fight would be over. Even, as Gandhi said, it always takes two to argue. If someone pulls out their energy, the fight is over. And that's such a good example, I think, of what dissociation does. It pulls you out of the center of everyday life, pulls you out of all your worries, thoughts about money, partnership, health, pulls out the energy, and collects the energy. And then you can also center the energy and direct it to something else that might be important to you. Yes, and the nice thing about it is that it's not just during the time of dissociation, but suddenly spreads throughout everyday life. More and more, until the whole everyday life is in flow. So that would be the advantage for everyday life. Yes, now we have talked so nicely about the advantages in everyday life. We have already discussed what dissociation occurs after how many minutes. But there are other benefits to spiritual development from practicing dissociation. For example, I can say that since then I've had flashes, deja vus, sudden insights. So these are advantages in everyday spiritual terms, I would say now. Exactly. That my dream memory has now massively improved again after it was splashed by an event. Yes, something. Exactly, those would be the advantages that would come to mind. So you also feel more energetic. Absolutely, more energetic. Or memories of other incarnations, or that you suddenly see things or have some insights. Or you save the energy for your own purposes, which you are pursuing there. Yes, what else I noticed in everyday life from a spiritual point of view? You can suddenly perceive a little more alternative realities, although you are not in dissociation at all. Everyday life is already changing in a spiritual way, so that more comes in without having to dissociate hard right now. Yes, Jonathan, then tell me about it. We are now coming to the experiences that we have had with dissociation. Of course, Jonathan has had far more experience than I have. And so I would say maybe you start. How did dissociation start for you? What was your first BAM experience or your first experience ever with dissociation? Or what was your first experience when you started dissociating? So when I started dissociating, I have to say, it took me a while to really clear my head and then I felt the energy building. Up inside me. And that sometimes manifested itself as yes, I then noticed that there are two ways that dissociation can be triggered, and I then realized for myself that it changes the speed of consciousness that every human being has. So here in everyday life we all have a very specific speed of consciousness, like a car that drives 50 constantly. Exactly. That's what it feels like, and through dissociation you can somehow change that, the speed. You either accelerate your consciousness or your speed of perception, or you slow it down. You will notice the difference, because the question is whether you will be warm or cold. Exactly. Because if you feel an inner chill rising inside you, It means that dissociation is now causing your speed of perception to slow down. I have to say that if I practice in bed with my eyes closed, for example, my speed of perception accelerates. But if I practice with my eyes open in everyday life, then I slow down my speed of consciousness. Exactly, is with me too. Same with you. Then you can suddenly perceive something like this, sometimes shadow suddenly. Yes. I then had really resounding success. For example, I rode around on my motorcycle once, and then stopped at a traffic light because the light went red. And at that moment I automatically went into a dissociative state and everything around me changed and slowed down. And the interesting thing that I then noticed was that the people I saw there, I saw a grandma who wanted to go through the traffic light, then another couple who wanted to go through the traffic light, in a different place I saw two teenagers pushing each. Other a little bit and stuff, and I saw all these things. Also a woman with a baby carriage. She would go through the traffic lights. And that's when I realized that they were doing it all on purpose. And that they really thought, yes, I am one now. I pretend to be an old woman going through the traffic lights. Or the woman with the pram too. I pretend to be the mother of a child who is pushing her child in front of her in the pram. Then everything around me kind of got a vibe from the fact that they were deliberately staging it all that way, and just for me. And not because I'm particularly important or because I'm more important than someone else, but I assume, or I've also heard it from reports from other people who deal with dissociation, that they have the impression that this whole drama is staged in the immediate present. Just for them. I can also confirm that. And then I also noticed that all the houses and things like that had changed. They still looked the same as before. They weren't different colors or anything, but looked like backdrops in some Hollywood Western town or something. As you know, in the old Hollywood films, the sets were constructed in such a way that only the fronts existed. Exactly. So that people had a background against which they could just play cowboys and Indians. And that's how it was with the normal houses in everyday life. They seemed to me like backdrops, as if only the fronts actually existed and as if there were actually no one in the houses. For example, that was a very interesting experience, I have to say, and that somehow showed me that the reality in which we live is really a kind of illusion, which we just because of the scenery and the extras who are supposed to entertain our everyday life around us, that somehow they are all staged like on a theater stage. And that's how I felt. I felt like I was on a big theater stage. Of course, you have to assume that it always affects the immediate environment. That means, at that moment only the immediate environment in the dissociation exists. Yes, exactly. And this is then also decisive for perception. What was it like for you? What kind of experience do you have to tell? Yes, it started like this for me. I mean, maybe one or the other knows. The Way to the True Adept, by Franz Bardon. That's how I started back then. And there was one of the tasks to create stillness of thought. And for that you had to do certain exercises 2 or 3 times a day. For 10 minutes in order to finally come to complete stillness of thought. And then I did that, I don't know, for 4, 5, 6 weeks and at some point I couldn't think at all anymore. Because before that I really liked to think a lot and it was very strange for me not to be able to think at all anymore. And the more I tried to think, the less I could think. Yes, and then I kept going with this stillness of thought. Well, I didn't know dissociation like that, but I've always done thought silence. and after a few weeks, I have no idea, then suddenly, I probably had accumulated so much energy that somehow the realization came through that everything is an illusion. All levels, all dimensions, everything is just one big game and everything is just one giant illusion. There is nothing genuine and true there. So according to the motto, it came through. And I didn't think it was nice at the time. I was still very young, couldn't do anything with it, didn't know anyone with whom I could talk about it or what kind of experience I had just had, or I wasn't able to read myself before because I had absolutely no idea what was going on now has happened. And yes, that was my experience, my first experience with dissociation. I couldn't think anymore. I couldn't think anymore for half a year, ha ha ha. And the only thing I really thought, I can't think anything. I want to think now. What am I supposed to think now? I just thought, I can't think. But otherwise there was just silence. And then at some point the realization came that everything is just an illusion and everything is structured like a game. A lot of levels. Everything is a game up to the highest level. And yes, wasn't so full for me back then. Without a clue, without anything. And that was my first experience. Ah, yeah, but I know that you have had very exciting experiences. Tell me about it. In an experience of dissociation, I suddenly realized that I was not alone, that there were several personalities within me. Loud Jonathan. Oh, and these Jonathans were, so to speak, arranged in strata. That is, the more attention or energy I gave to one part of me, the higher it was in the stratum, and the parts that I had given less attention to throughout my life were in the lower strata. And those from the lower classes were lifted up in dissociation, and then I was able to really get to know parts of myself that I had almost always missed. And that was of course very interesting, because I could call each of them personality aspects. Each of these aspects that were then brought into my consciousness, I was then able to get to know them. Yes, as I said, and I was also. Able to recognize what skills they had bring yourself. So each of these personality aspects already had an ability. And then it was so that whenever I was in a personality aspect with my consciousness, then I also looked at reality in this way. For example, I also had a very loving personality aspect and everything around me was kind of loving and beautiful, positive. But I also had a depressive one, who then observed everything depressed. Or there was one who was very intellectual. He then just intellectually analyzed everything in his environment, etc. Except those were all personality aspects, or one could also say character traits, one could also say that I became aware of them at that moment. And because of that, it was then possible for me to get to know many of these personality aspects. And that finally caused me to get into a state in which I could then combine all of these personality aspects with one another or combine them. She could integrate. And through that integration, I was then able to enter a state where I could perceive through all aspects at once. So these are such interesting things that you can experience in dissociation. Because this overall perspective that I then took up there also gave me the opportunity to recognize that duality does not exist at all. And that it is only an illusion, an interpretation from a personality aspect. And when I looked at other people, I saw that they always judged the world based on a certain personality aspect. Mostly based on their favorite aspects to deal with and from which they judged the world, and of course they were biased because they only had one aspect perspective. But then getting into a state where you can perceive all perspectives is like doing a jigsaw puzzle. You have a certain area in your puzzle where you see, ah yes, this will be from the tree and this might be a house. but in that moment you can suddenly see the whole puzzle and see the whole puzzle, then see the big picture of a certain situation. And of course that gave me the opportunity to discover a lot about myself. Yes, my experience wasn't that deep. What I once noticed in the dissociation is that I was suddenly an observer. And then I noticed that all aspects talk to each other. So there's no silence or anything. It's like in a huge classroom and they're all just chatting with each other. And when you listen, you also notice that they are talking to each other or what they are talking to each other. And then you can also distinguish the voices that you have in your head a little better, i.e. the different character traits and aspects and such, and I found that very funny. Then it turned out, which aspects are there? I probably don't have them to the full extent you've seen, but I do have a few. He was in such a mood. He is in such a mood. He is in such a mood. He talks to him. He talks to him and they cooperate with each other, etc. Yes, that was one of those experiences that I also had during dissociation. Yes, I also found experiences very exciting where you are suddenly transported from 1 second to the next in dissociation to another place. Once it was like that, I dissociated for quite a long time, and suddenly my consciousness clicked. These shifts in reality are always very sudden and very amazing, aren't they? Yes, it's pretty amazing. And I was sitting on a curb, with pavement all over the place in front of me and carriages driving by. And I sort of identified the scene. Yes, turn of the century England. Something like that, for example, that can all of a sudden you change the reality you are in right now. Switch to another reality in a second. And you have to stay calm at that moment, because many are of course afraid and think, what is happening to me here? What is happening there? And that's why you have to have a lot of trust in your higher self, that everything that's happening is correct. And in this way you can also learn to accept and accept it and also open yourself up to letting your consciousness expand in this way. Or in another situation it was also the case that I was suddenly in a different place from 1 second to the next. There I sat in a really chic, yes, even at the turn of the century, in a really chic armchair next to a fireplace in an old living room, as one imagines it, in the colonial style, and then I found myself there again. And all while awake. So I didn't go to bed and go to sleep to dream. But from the waking state within a second click, I was over there. That means your whole environment was suddenly different. Yes, that means you wouldn't have seen the camera in front of you, but a chimney in front of you, so to speak. Yeah, right. At once. And of course those are very interesting experiences that you can have when you suddenly switch to another age or another time epoch. Let me say, and the complete data system, which the perception perceives so presently, from 1 second on the other is exchanged, complete. And it is quite clear that this is possible, since all incarnations are also running at the same time. That means you were probably really sitting in that armchair at that moment, just projected your consciousness there and sat there. Yes, that's really, really exciting, that's true. So this is very exciting to experience. Yes, I used to dissociate while driving. I kind of liked doing that. And suddenly, it was no longer me who was steering the wheel. And then I realized that I wasn't in charge. I have a self inside me that drives a car, but I'm not that at all. And I was actually next to it, or rather behind it. I was suddenly the observer who saw me driving. So, yes, that was very but at that moment I wasn't worried about hitting someone because I knew very well that this part of me, it's driving, it always does the job when it's driving. That I have a driver aspect, so to speak, that does it automatically anyway, this aspect. And then I was able to observe and realize, yes, that's not actually me, but the one behind it, so to speak. Yes, but it worked. He drove on. Yes. Yeah, right. In the dissociation, one can also recognize in oneself which roles one is playing and which routine actions we practice again and again in everyday life, which have become so automated that they can also run on their own. In the dissociation, you can notice something like you with driving a car. There's a part of us that's been doing it routinely for years. And then when you step into dissociation and then step into observer, you can watch yourself mastering that action or situation just like you always do. Yes, but at that moment I was no longer the aspect that was driving. That was separated at that moment, because I observed from behind how this aspect or how I drive. Yes, but I know that you have had a very exciting experience. And now we all want to hear it. Yeah. Well, that was really one of the craziest experiences I've had there. And I dissociated for a very long time in a row one evening. I was also in a good mood and had good energy. I had already collected enough energy through other dissociations and thought I would keep the energy and use it for a larger dissociation phase. And that's what I did. And that was pretty crazy, because somehow I managed, well, I don't know, 15 minutes of pure dissociation. I just fainted. I lost consciousness because I really overdid it. Because I always said to myself, no, I wouldn't do it for more than 10 minutes. But somewhere I always had a part of me that said, let's see what happens when. Dot you, longer than 10 minutes might. Let's give this a try. And then I tried that too. About 15 minutes, I guess I must have managed to dissociate and then passed out. And when I woke up again, I wasn't gone for long, maybe 20, 30 seconds I was gone. After that, I had physically changed reality. That means I switched from an alternate reality, i.e., from my everyday reality, to an alternate reality and stayed there. My neighbor was suddenly different. There was a completely different neighbor. Apparently, I was even a bit of a friend with him, because he used to knock on the knocker's door once a week and wanted to show me a great CD he had that I should definitely listen to of his music. And the neighbor who was there before, I had no contact at all with him, I hardly saw him. My long-term partnership, which I had at the time, did not even exist in this reality. We were just buddies then, that was all. Or when I walked through town, people I had never met greeted me. You me, yes. I'd never seen them before, but they seemed to know me. Or people I had just known in the old reality, in the new reality, they had a completely different attitude towards me. Some were only very distant acquaintances, others didn't know me at all. I once approached two women in town, they looked at me with big eyes and said, "Who are you?" And I was like, "Hey, so of course." Of course I had to play a role at the time. Yes, of course. I had to act like everything was normal. I didn't want to be conspicuous in any way. And then of course I always took on a passive role in order to first check out the environment, how everything is structured, who is somehow involved with whom and such. Who knew me, who didn't know me and the like. And so I could see some things that had changed. But many things were still the same. I still lived in the same apartment. The furniture was all the same. So that's it. The phone number I had was the same. Other elements were actually exchanged. They were very different. That's crazy. And not only that. But when I looked in the mirror, I saw that I looked a bit older than before. And so over time I was able to find that there I had shifted into a reality where I was 10 years older. That doesn't mean that dissociation always makes you look 10 years older. Yes, that would be tragic. It was only because of my long dissociation, which I had practiced there, that because of my ignorance at the time, I naturally ended up in some random reality that I hadn't been able to choose before. And yes, of course I had to rebuild some things, and other things were already given in this new reality. I then noticed that actually every reality has its advantages and disadvantages, and that was also the case in the new reality. And yes, you could really say then that I am one of those who actually came from another reality, from another parallel universe, so to speak. Right, as you might sometimes see in science fiction. Or at Star Trek. Yes, exactly. You are from another reality. We must see that we bring you back to your original reality. Because you can't stay here in this alternate reality. Well, I could stay. It wasn't like anyone was interested in somehow bringing me back to another reality now, except myself. Because, of course, at first I had the desire to return to my old reality, because I was just used to it. Yes, you were used to them. And I knew her much better than the new one. The new one was already a bit new territory for me, because I just didn't have the information of the self that had spent its life in this reality at my disposal. I didn't get an update. I still had my memories from the old reality, and of course I always had to compare them. Compare with the information from the new reality. But I didn't manage to come back. I dissociated, but I couldn't really dissociate for 15 minutes at a time. And when I managed to dissociate for that long, other effects would appear. But now there is no way to switch back. And that's why I keep telling people, don't dissociate for more than 10 minutes, especially as a beginner. For example, if someone has a talent for being able to dissociate quickly and well, don't overdo it. Because then something like that can happen, that we switch from one reality to the other and you can't come back. Yeah. Luck for me. And that was one of the most interesting experiences I had. And what do you think happened to the self that was in this reality, the Jonathan that was here? Do you think he went over to the other neighboring reality? I don't know where he went. I haven't found him. So there are two assumptions I have. Either I shifted into a reality that was empty. Okay, so you were here practically only as a shell, as a body shell, so to speak, with an ego that everyone has. Correct. And in which I with my... Yes, how shall I put it? Shifted with myself into this ego in this alternate reality. That is, as I was able to observe through many dissociation exercises, or sessions, that there are realities that stand empty. And there are realities that are occupied. So when you say it's empty, you mean that Jonathan's body is already there, but there's nobody in there. Yes. So that means that every human being consists of two selves, an ego, shall I say, an everyday ego and an inner ego. And the inner ego is what can switch between realities. And that's why I assume that the reality I changed into was just empty. That there was only... What's your other, your second assumption? The second possibility is that we simply swapped. Oh yeah, okay. That he's now sitting in my old reality and I'm sitting in the new one. And he will certainly be as surprised as I was surprised at the time. Yeah, dot, yes. And of course that is also an option. Yes, and that's probably why I couldn't go back, because then it was considered occupied. One does not know, although that's not entirely logical either, but whatever it is, you're here now and you've had a pretty crazy experience. So I still favor assumption number one. Here it was empty. Here was the possibility that there was no self sitting here, only the ego. And that's why I was able to go in there. I guess that's something you also know from dreams. For example, there are lucid dreams in which you can do anything. But there are also lucid dreams in which you cannot do anything. For example, I had a lucid dream, so I thought, oh, I'm in a lucid dream, so I can walk on water like Jesus. And then I walked over the water, I wanted to run, and I fell in with a splat. Why didn't it work? There are already realities where the physical laws are still active and you cannot change them despite your lucidity. And then there are also lucid dreams, where you can actually change everything. And I think there is a connection. Yes, very exciting. Yes, that was really one of the most interesting experiences. Yes, tell me one or two more experiences that you had with dissociation. So one of the most impressive experiences really was when I saw my matrix case for the first time. Oh yes, of course. I also dissociated for a very long time. I probably dissociated for around 10 minutes and suddenly I noticed a shell around me. It looked like a web, like a giant spider cocoon, you could say egg-shaped. And if I stretched out my arm, I could even touch this very shell. I could physically touch her. I could even push against it and it stretched. Well, it wasn't somehow stable or solid or anything or rigid, let me put it that way, but it was elastic, almost like a kind of rubber wall. Except that it also consisted of a living tissue. And then I always pushed against it, in all directions and such. Strangely enough, I wasn't afraid at that moment, because normally you might feel imprisoned. You're suddenly inside an egg and can't get out because everything isn't really open or something. But it was not so, and then I kept pressing against it and then I noticed that this shell, yes, how should I explain that? Yes, that every human being has this shell, and every human sits in this egg, shall I say, in this matrix shell. And on the inner wall of this matrix shell you can perceive this physical reality that you are now perceiving at the moment. That means you're looking at monitors in there. Right. Even as I sit here now, I'm actually sitting in this matrix shell and everything I see here, the couch, the table, the wall, everything is on the inside of this matrix shell. It's really a kind of cinema. I'm sitting in the cinema and looking at what I'm seeing right now on the screen. It's just that I identified so much with this situation here that I sort of slipped into the film and I think I'm one of those actors in the film. That means right now, as I'm sitting here, I think I'd be Jonathan. And I think I'm part of this daily soap. Yes, but in reality I'm sitting in a cinema and just watching. And of course that was a great realization for me to perceive it that way. So I could still report on many more experiences about this matrix shell. I also have in my book, Spiritual Dissociation. Well, I could tell you many more experiences that I have perceived in this matrix shell. Right. How reality built up within the matrix shell. How it suddenly appeared or situations where suddenly the screen went off and everything around me was just black. Mm-hmm. and I could sort of see into infinity what exists outside of the matrix shell. But it was just black, pitch black, there was nothing. So things like that, which I then also noticed. So the dissociation will bring you at some point, when you are really advanced and can dissociate for very, very many minutes at a time, will ultimately bring you to get to know this matrix shell. And then I was also able to recognize in this matrix shell that when I open it, that I then leave the matrix, because the whole matrix that I perceive here now, that I perceive throughout my life, all only exists because I sit in this matrix shell. So as soon as this matrix shell is opened by me, just like a chick hatches from the egg at some point, I will also hatch from the egg and then leave this matrix. And that's just when you get that far, you'll be amazed. What is it? What this reality and the matrix is all about and where we actually really are. We just believe that we are where we are right now. We only notice that because, as moviegoers, we identify with the role we're watching all the time. And so we believe we're in there. And that's an important insight that you have to have. And for the advanced ones who are dissociating, at some point they will have no choice but to perceive this matrix shell. But it's a long way to get there, because you have to be advanced in dissociation to get there. But when you get there, you'll be amazed at how the world is really structured, what all this is supposed to be about, where it's all supposed to lead and where the end is. Yes, Jonathan, those were exciting experiences that you and of course we want you to have your own experiences, so dissociate and practice, learn, well and diligently, so that at some point you can get to know the matrix shell or simply shape your reality as you wish.